Hello everybody, welcome. I'm just very pleased to be able to welcome you all to SOAS. My name is Parvathi Raman. I'm chair of the Centre for Migration and Diaspora Studies here, and I'll tell you a little bit about that in a second. But I'm really pleased to be able to welcome you to the launch of the Anglo-Asiatic Arts and Heritage Alliance, which my good friend Hai Ching is going to come and tell us all about in a minute. But before we get to that, we're very happy to be a part of this. I don't really know what to call it. We've got so many people involved in this, and that's why I think it'd be good to hear what Hai Ching has to say, because he's really drawn together quite a dazzling array of different organisations and individuals. The centre at SOAS has been going for the last 9 years, and you'll be aware that issues surrounding migration, diaspora communities in Britain and internationally have been very much at the forefront of news, public concern, etc., etc. So the centre, one of the reasons it was founded really, was to bring about research, which was about a cross-fertilisation of ideas, about being transdisciplinary, about connecting with the community, about having approaches that weren't just academic, but involved alliances with artists, with the theatre, with music, with different approaches to how actually get information out to the public in ways that were meaningful. Because I'm sure you realise that what needs to happen at the moment is dialogues which actually challenge the very damaging ways that migrants, diaspora communities, are actually portrayed in the media, for example. I heard somebody in the audience actually saying earlier, why does identity matter? Yeah, and it's a really good question, a central question, if you like. And I think that's some of the issues that we'll be looking at today. So just to say that the centre is very pleased to be able to work with this fantastic, I think, initiative, which I think comes out of the Sea Arts Project. And I'm going to hand over to Hai Ching, who's going to tell us a little bit more about what's going to happen over the coming years as we get this alliance together. And welcome to SOAS. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Paru. Hello. How are you? Right, AAAHA is an alliance of different Pan-Asian organizations and artists I've been working with over the past few years. And I thought, well, it's time to pull everybody together because of the globality of the world and how national boundaries don't really mean anything now. And then as I was putting it together, I realized that most of the continents in the world begin with A. So we've got Asia, obviously, and then we've got Africa and America and America and Australia, and that leaves Europe. But after Brexit, what happens? So we shall wait. We shall see what happens. But we'd still like to be included in this. So the whole thing is to actually have an interface between artists and academics and think tanks, because I think it's quite important to understand why we are creating art and for what purpose. And this is a question of identity. What does it all mean to each of us as we traverse the world and we go from place to place getting information and, you know, basically finding fulfillment for ourselves? And then what happens to our own individual identity then? So I sort of decided that what we'll do with AAAHA is actually have two broad... Oh, the picture's up. Good. All right. You see, we have the partners on the left and the binationals. And how this works is that the partners are what we're looking at in this country, essentially. So that's the universities, the artists here, and think tanks here. And out of that, we're looking at creating a cross-drifts festival, which would be some vehicle for artists to program their work. So that's up for discussion and for panels to discuss what on earth is going to happen with their art and why they're doing it. And out of that, we're trying to sneak in a World Cultural Center somewhere. And hopefully that will begin to develop organically with the different universities and different campuses. So that's the aim of that one. But another very crucial point is what we're looking at in terms of dialogue between two nations. Because I think that when we have a binational company, you're then able to create an arch and a rainbow, a bridge between two countries that are specific to those two countries. We we usually have national companies, the National Theatre, the Royal Ballet, Royal Opera House, and all that. But those are very, very within a kind of parochial context of a national company. What then if you have a binational company? And this is the thing that I'm very, very keen to explore, because I've been working with Indian artists for the past year and a half. And one of the things that's emerged is this dialogue that I'm having with them. And also, we thought that it'd be really good to look at what Cameron's saying these days, like next year is the UK-India Year of Culture. So what on earth does that mean? I thought maybe it means Britindia, which is what I thought I'd put together, Britain and India. So what we've got here is a structure in which we're hoping to have a Britindia UK, which is a charity and not-for-profit company, with a Britindia in India, and that these two companies then share a lot of work through the artists in each of these countries. And so we've got below there a whole group of outcomes, hopefully. These will all attract sponsors, which I think we're doing okay. Grants, commercial companies as well, because we are looking at how we can sustain the work of artists, and perhaps commercial projects, objects, these might be very important to consider. And so we're also exploring Britapur, because we're working with Singapore artists, and that seems to be coming along naturally, so that's what we're doing. So it's today I'm actually trying to pull people together so that you can introduce yourselves to each other, get to know each other, and out of that, perhaps create some synergies that we could work together. So everything is really open to everybody else, and I hope that we can enjoy working together. That's the main thing, really, to enjoy working together and see what happens. And I probably need to brush up on this. But anyway, I hope you understand what I mean. And if you want to ask me a little bit more about what I'm talking about, if you can make any sense of it, I'll be out there somewhere later on. But I'm going to hand you over now to Dr. Mark Hobart, who has been my support for the last 10 years, because we started up Sea Arts together and Sea Arts Fest, which has been running for the last 3 years, and in a sense, Cross Drifts is an expansion of that. Thank you, Mark.
Okay, thank you. Well, thank you all for coming. It's splendid to see such a turnout. I'm an academic, formerly. I was Professor of Critical Media and Cultural Studies here. And Hai Ching Nimade Pujawati, who is a Balinese classical dancer, and I set up Sea Arts coincidentally the same year as the Centre for Migration Studies. We, in the first phase, we didn't know quite what we were doing. We had a nice name, Sea Arts. Hai Ching is responsible, don't blame me. And to begin with, it had a number of functions, but the main concern was that Southeast Asia, I mean, I know that all Asian peoples in the UK feel that they're rather marginalised, but by goodness, Southeast Asia is marginalised even by standards, because South Asia, China and Japan are big countries, big blocks with attention. Southeast Asia is horribly fragmented. And so one of our first jobs was, in E.M. Forster's famous expression, only connect. And the connection was double. It was to introduce Southeast Asians in the UK to one another, and through that they realised how much they had in common, and also to link Southeast Asians in the UK with Southeast Asians in the country in question. Here, and I think that Hai Ching and most of us share this account, the idea of the nation state as a bounded entity is something that only UK border agency really takes seriously. With cheap tickets, people are moving to and fro. With Skype and social media, it's almost meaningless. And so part of the concern was, how do you turn the very rapid movement of people and the communications into something that works? So in the first stage, we were pulling together two organisations. One was Lila Baba, which is an Indonesian dance company, and also an organisation called Balinese Dance, actually run by Nimade Pujawati. And we set up a YouTube channel. Just to give you figures, there are 150 videos up on the YouTube channel, 50,000 views, but actually that's dwarfed by Balinese Dance, which has about 1,000 to 1,300 hits a day. So it's not, that's the point about a connected world. It's not a specialist interest. From right across the world, Romania, Peru, people are logging in daily. However, we have to get out and reach them. I will just only run through very briefly some of the things we've done. We've had a couple of Heritage Lottery Fund grants. One was called the Gamelan Trail. There are 100 Indonesian gamelan in the UK. Why? What on earth's going on? What attracts people, Brits and people from all over the world, to join? We recently had Cambodian Recollections, looking at the memories of Cambodians who were forced out of Cambodia and during those appalling times. We've also had Arts Council funding. We had Balinese have a wonderful gamelan called, it's a marching and fighting gamelan consisting of gongs and things you can beat prior to beating people. And that led on to really our most important activity, which is in a sense a predecessor for what's going on here, which was the Sea Arts Festival, which ran with Arts Council funding for the last 3 years. 13, 14, 15. And that it has also done other things like sponsor new choreographies. So in other words, it's very open. To some extent, basically, we make it up as we go along. Because the problem, if you have a fixed agenda, you discover yourself hidebound by your agenda. And so this is where I think Hai Ching's remarks were very helpful, in a sense. Enjoying ourselves, reaching out to people and so on, I think is key. And in a sense, that's all I have to say. I hope that we started something. We now want to see where it goes. Thank you.
Right, now I'm going to call upon our two cultural envoys of Britindia. Now, this is a kind of a model we're working at to see how we can develop this binational company. And I've been working with a wonderful visual artist, the prize-winning Ketna Patel, who spent 20 years in Singapore and is now relocated safely back in the UK. Yes, and Bhagya, Lakshmi, who is the leading Bharatanatyam teacher of her generation in this country. And she is our performing arts cultural envoy. And they're both Indians, so that helps.
Hopefully.
Do you need me to do this? Are you happy to?
Just those buttons, this, right? Yeah. Okay. Hello, everybody. Gosh, this is so exciting. I've just moved back after 20 years in this tiny island, which was only 40 miles across, and now suddenly I'm in Britain, and it's just brilliant, brilliant to be here. A little bit about myself. I am a typical Patel from East Africa, so third generation East African Gujarati, who moved here when I was 14, and then I studied design and architecture. And my first job as an architect was in Singapore, where I went for 1 year, and ended up staying 20 years. And I left Singapore 3 years ago, and have been spending half my time in India and half my time here. India is a place that I've been visiting for the last 20 to 30 years, like not just as a tourist, but as an investigator, an artist, an architect, whatever, you know, through work, through family, etc. And even though I'm sitting on my desk in London every day, most of my conversations are on Skype with India. I mean, they start waking me up at 5 o'clock in the morning and our meetings start, and the same with Singapore. So I think I'm occupying this virtual space more and more. I'm not physically in India quite a lot. I'm not physically here all the time, and I'm kind of in this middle space, which is all about ideas and excavations of memories and cultural narratives. So Meeting Hai Ching has been a real highlight in my life this year, thank you. And the fact that Narendra Modi was in town recently and him and Cameron announced this big initiative next year of the culture year, I think has kind of heralded this term, Britindia. I hope you like the logo. That's our like first bash at the logo. But do you want to talk about this Flurry of Ferocity, huh?
I will.
You will? Okay, go on.
No, you finish yours, that's fine.
No, because it's...
can come back.
Okay, I can jump a couple of slides.
I'll come back to this.
Okay, so although my background is in architecture and design, I'm very... I think I've always been compelled to tell stories of individuals who haven't had their stories represented, so underrepresented people, people who are invisible because they're just born in a small village or maybe in an obscure part of the world. I get really wound up when I go into a bookshop and I look at books on world art, and then it's just dominated by America and Europe, and you know, where's Gujarat, or where's Kenya, or you know, where are all these other spaces? So the hijacking of world history through these large isms is something that I'm trying to crack open by telling stories of individuals. So a lot of other people call what I do pop art, because I guess it's an investigation of popular culture. So that's the culture of everyday people, and I document their stories, and then I reformat them and retell them on a variety of different applications, which sometimes have a commercial leaning so that they can be propagated through different layers of society, because I'm also trying to break away from this white-cubed, elitist, artistic experience where you just go and buy a very expensive painting and it ends up in some banker's house or something, you know. So how to get these stories percolating down through all the different layers of society. So whether it's fashion, furniture, you know, cars, limited edition prints, etc. That's been very much a part of this larger project that I'm doing called Planet Pop. And under Planet Pop comes Africa Pop, Asia Pop, Cuba Pop. Under India Pop can be Gujarat Pop. So by pop, I mean that I am trying to pop open a story. And if I do that enough times, as many times as I can, then I'm popping open a different narrative in the world. So this is a project that I'm currently working on, which will really take off in July, August. This will be Britindia's first offering. So I bought an old Rolls Royce on eBay, and it was cheaper because it was this horrible brown color. And I composed a very, you know, slightly controversial narrative, perhaps, but it's about multi-dimensional Britain. And I mean, there's a lot going on in there. You'll see in July. I brought in history and Renaissance paintings, and there's a lot of. It's quite cheeky. It's quite dark, but you know, done in a fun way. So the idea is that together with the film crew, I'm going to drive around parts of Britain where there has been a history of a lot of immigration, and interview individuals who have interesting stories to tell, document these stories, collect them, form a depository, and then come up with a film and a body of images and work, which will then continue in terms of derivatives. You know, by derivatives, I mean it could be it can take on many different applications. So that's the Diary of Transience project, which is going to be happening later this summer. Next week, I'm going to Himachal Pradesh, where I've been spending quite a lot of time recently, because another big aspect of my work for the last two decades has been to investigate the gap between rural parts of the world and the urban world. For example, in India, it's a shocking statistic, but every minute, 30 individuals move from a rural area into a city. So just in the last 10 minutes that you know I've been talking, probably 300 people have moved from a village to a city. And I my studio is in a city called Pune, which is one of the fastest growing cities in India. And you know, it just cannot cope. I mean, our rubbish doesn't get picked up. Our water is not piped in anymore. It comes on water tankers every day. There's traffic jams. It's polluted. You know, I mean, cities are not coping. And yet the Indian government wants to make 75 new cities by 2030. So I feel that there is not enough of a scrutiny on the human aspect of these hollowed out rural areas and what it's doing to our individual identities. And even though I was in India 2 months ago when the budgets were announced, and the focus this year for the Indian government is to spend most of the money on rural areas, but they're constantly talking about infrastructure, you know, where to give more electricity, how to tarmac roads, where to build schools, etc. And that's good and that's important. But where I want to come in is to put the spotlight on individual identities, because the more you can see yourself in the mirror and the more you take ownership of who you are and the narrative that you belong in, the more confident you are as a person, the more self-respect you have, the more creative you become. There's, you know, it gives rise to entrepreneurship and all sorts of things. But if you don't have this basic self-image and self-identity intact right from the beginning, I think it doesn't matter how many jobs you keep creating, because you know there's going to be a big gap. So I'll just wind up very quickly. This project is really about I'm organizing a month's residency in a tiny village called Guner in Himachal Pradesh, where we're inviting 10 artists from different disciplines to come and spend a month there. They're from the backgrounds of architecture, music, writing, installation, different things. They will come and spend a month in this village and excavate local stories that have perhaps are in the danger of becoming extinct, whether it's old building materials or an old song that's forgotten or an old recipe that needs, you know, that is just kind of going to die out when the grandmother dies, or whatever platform the artist is coming with. They're going to use that location for a month to excavate these stories, and my job, together with my partner's job, this half German, half Indian guy Frank, who lives in the village, is to amplify these stories and propagate them nationally and hopefully internationally. And if we do this successfully as a pioneering case study, then we can replicate this in villages all over India. And I think we would have quite a compelling audience that will take us seriously, because already people are lamenting about this big divide. It's just that there aren't enough devices that are measuring the problem in order to even come up with a solution. So this is one such device, and it's a lot of people call it artivism, so it's a cross between art and activism. Right, I think that's my bit done for today. Bhagya?
Hello. Sorry about my makeup, I'm coming from a show, so it's just too much, I know. So I am Bhagya Lakshmi Thyagarajan. I'm also from India. I've been here for 6 years, and I am from a family of artists, and I basically have lived in the Indian traditional family from my grandparents to my father to my brother, and everyone is an artist right now. My brother, even though he works for Microsoft, he's still a guitarist, and you know. When I moved to the UK, I didn't know what to expect, because even though I have traveled quite a lot performing Indian art and doing workshops and everything, I came in 2010, and what I saw was there was already a huge appreciation for our kind of form of dance and music and everything. But I felt that there was this gap which was not, there was this huge gap which was not filled up, which was between India and the Indian artists in the UK. So there was a huge space that we could cover. So I met Hai Ching in, I think, 3 years back, and slowly we started talking about filling up this gap, the bridge that we wanted to. So that's where the idea of Britindia came in, even though we didn't start calling it for a while. So this is Britindia's story. What we started doing is we went to a place in Rajasthan, in India, the northern India. We went to Jaipur, and we got our own place, which is called Amer Cultural Center, which has been leased to us for the next 5 years. And we have around 30 artists who live there and who practice there and who create their work, which was showcased last year here at the Glastonbury Festival, at the Leicester Festival and everything, and which was only possible because of the kind of help we could offer it to them. Even though last time it was fully sponsored by FIPA, the organization that I work for. This year what we are looking for is to expand that, how much more we can do, how much more we can help them. The village which we want to adopt in the near future, we want to turn, like how Ketna was talking about, we want to turn the village into a cooler place where everyone can go and everyone can see these artists and live with them, learn how they do their day-to-day lives, how they perform. Plus what we are looking at is a lot of education and things like that for the children who are really, really small and they don't have any access to the education in India, but they are okay. They have to work because there is not much money, so they have to work in order to bring money for them. So that is one of the major aspects that we are looking at for Britindia. And then the next thing that we do a lot is educational workshops here in the UK. I facilitate them myself or my colleagues. Like there is another person called Sid Shaha. He's not with us today, but. And we travel and we talk about the Indian culture, which is very much present in UK. At the same time, which the parents here are very keen for their children to learn at the same time. So that is something that we facilitate quite a lot in this in the country. I run a dance school called Bhaglakshmi's Academy for Performing Arts. So one of the major things that we do is we train the students here in the UK, we travel back to India, we use the musicians from the India, and then we do this collaboration with them where the dancer, if the Indian person from UK wants to be an Indian dancer, what all they need to understand. So that is one of the things that we do. So that those are the musicians. They are the top class musicians from India, and she has been training with me for 2 years just for this one show. And then we traveled and we did this. At the same time, the girls above are also my students here, and we have been practicing a curriculum called from the ISTD. And in June, 60 of them are going for an examination, which will qualify them to be able to facilitate workshops or being an Indian classical dancer in the UK. Plus, we have all, FIPA has been collaborating with Kathakali artists in the UK, where we also do HLF funding. So I have been touring with them for the last 3 years, where we go into small villages and where we try to tell them what Indian art is all about and how much we have similarities or differences, and we try to bridge that gap in between. One of the good things that's happened to us is while I was in India, we met the Minister of Culture for India, and he is very supportive of what we do here at AAHA for Britindia, and he would like to take this forward with us. So I think that is something that we would love to take up on and explore the possibilities. So if there is anything you would like to know, I'll be available after this and you can come speak to me. Thank you so much.
Now, Dominic, the spotlight shines on you. Dominic is a wonderful theatre director I met recently, and he's been researching on Indian soldiers in World War I, and it's one of the things that we like to do as Britindia, to develop this a production with the content of your research. And Caroline is the administrator for Among Men of Theatre, right?
Yes, definitely.
Good afternoon, everyone. Lovely to see everyone.
Yes.
How are you? Everyone okay at the back? Everyone okay at the side? Good. It's a pleasure to be sharing our work, but also hearing about exciting work that people are doing. And I hope that the conversations will continue outside of this forum as well. My name's Dominic, and I'm just going to correct Hwee-Ching. We met many years ago where we both had offices at the Albany in Deptford. And he created a show which I was quite interested in. So I'm just going to tell you a tiny bit before we speak about our project. Had cabaret songs from the 1940s from China, yeah, Shanghai in particular. And just that thought of that, that concept interested me. So I saw his show. But we had, you know, we did share offices and we did, our paths did cross. This is my colleague, Caroline Goffin. We've both been interested in the story of Indian soldiers in World War One. So much so, I feel like the Remington man, that I acquired the rights to the book to promote this story. And it's the only novel about Indian soldiers in World War One. And I'm going to let Caroline start us off and then I'll carry on.
Yeah, well, we've got this slide up, which I think is a good starter on it. Our project is called Salt of the Sarkar, which is a phrase that the relates to these Indian soldiers who, it's a fairly unknown story that at the very beginning of the First World War, immediately war was declared, it was realised by the British government that there were not enough really British soldiers to hold the Western Front, and even if they started recruiting immediately, they couldn't get enough soldiers to the front for a few months because all Kitchener's volunteers had to do a little bit of training first before they were ready. But these soldiers were on the northwest frontier and other places, and they'd got active experience of fighting, but not the sort of fighting that was going to take place. And they, the Salt of the Sarkar is a phrase that they would use relating to their relationship to the government. And this book that Dominic shared, Across the Black Waters, is the story told from the soldier's aspect, the ordinary soldier from an Indian village, as he came and arrived in France within a few weeks of the First World War and ended up in his tropical kit on the Western Front in the first very bitter winter of 1914. And it is a fabulous story that is so worth reading because it tells you what they felt about Europe when they arrived and how strange they thought the customs were, and then how they, you know, how the story developed. And it is actually based on history. And I've got this book out, and I've looked in the archives of the story of the 57th Wilds Rifles, and it follows this absolutely the story of behind the soldiers that are featured here. But this is a novel, and it's a read, and you feel that you identify with those individual soldiers. And this book is at the heart of Salt of the Sarkar. Mulk Raj Anand is an amazing literary genius who, I always feel he inhabits this space. He was in Bloomsbury in the 1920s and 30s. He knew all the literary eminent people from the Bloomsbury set and all the rest, and mixed and mingled here. He published his book in 1940 at the beginning of the Second World War. And and we want him to be known. We want this story to be known. And we want especially to bring the voices of the soldiers from undivided India, whether they were Hindu, Muslim, Sikh, they all fought side by side in this particular regiment. And there were others who weren't any of those labels. They had other identities, but they were all part of the British Indian Army, who travelled to Europe and also the Middle East. and we want their voices to come to life through the novel, through the letters home, which are housed not far away in the British Library, and to bring that story to life however we can. And I've already mentioned the soldiers, and these are the actual soldiers from this regiment in the end of October 1914, within a week of their arriving on the Western Front. It's a posed picture, it's in Belgium, but that is actually their front line and the trench that they managed to dig out, because first weeks of the war, it was fast moving, they didn't have the big trenches you sometimes see in the films. And these were the actual men. These were Punjabi Muslimmen. The actual soldiers in this book were slightly different. They were Hindu, probably Hindu Dogras, but they fought side by side in the same regiment. So I think I'll hand back to Dominic.
Okay.
And shall I move on or?
No, stay on that. Yeah. Stay on this one first. Yeah. Okay. I just have to tell you how I came to be connected to this story, because like most school children who've grown up in Britain, you learn about World War One and Remembrance Day. You know, I mean, I remember being sort of, you know, especially with my gran, and just sort of being very aware of Remembrance Day. And but you do study World War One about three times by the time you're 16. So I actually thought I really knew everything about World War One when I was 16. And I did, because all 16-year-olds know everything. So I had a double dose of it, because not only from the history end we had a specialist subject for World War One, but we also had it in literature. So when I started working, I joined a company called Tara Arts, and that was my first job. I was learning to read and write Urdu as an adult, and one of our administrators sent me to the India Records Library on Blackfriars Road, and she said, "My sister's the head of Urdu, and Shivana will show you some stuff to inspire you, perhaps." So I did. I hopped along to the India Records Library. I had a great time there. And before I left, she said, "And here's some letters sent by the Indian soldiers in World War One." Of course, you know, it was like a sort of like a new thing for me. Were there any Indian soldiers? I had no idea that there were any soldiers from the British Empire at all, let alone Indians, which were the largest amount. And so that led to a journey of discovery. And the first thing I did was I got my theatre company to do a show. And they did create a show. And Ruxana Emmet was the person who scripted that show. And it was a devised show with the actors based on the letters home. And then, as we went along, this was the 80s and the late 80s. So by the time it came to the 1990s, and I can see, is Mark still here? Mark's still there. He just told me that he remembers the show that we did at Hackney Empire, so which was based on this novel. So by 98, I decided to write to Mulk Rajanand, who was now in his 90s and alive and well in Bombay. I'm sorry, I can't call it Mumbai, because all the songs are about Bombay, not about Mumbai. I wrote to him, and he gave us his permission and his blessing to adapt it and to stage it. So we did that, and we did a small tour as well. And this is the young Mulk. And that's probably what he looked like when he was in the 1920s and 30s here. This is a man who fought alongside people like George Orwell and others in the Spanish Civil War. And he could see his father was a soldier in the Dogra Regiment, and which was also mentioned in this book. So he knew about this soldier, but he also, our communication in the 90s, he pointed out that as a very young boy, he was born in Peshawar, and which is now in Pakistan. And I'm just remembering that partition is only 70 years next year. And he remembers the soldiers coming back home to Peshawar. And there were, out of 500, he once wrote, there were only 50 that came back. And those that did come back, how they might have been, you know, some of them had no more limbs anymore. And it was something that he really remembered and moved him. And he knew then that he would one day want to tell their story. And that's more, I think, in around about 2000.
This was taken by one of our colleagues who went there and actually visited him and was able to, you know, hear his story direct and bring back some pictures.
Great. Do you want to go to the next slide? So this is our production, we had the good sort of fortune to have people like Vincent Abraham working with us, and Raza Jaffrey, and it was a cast really of very experienced actors and younger actors, and I think that we were all very proud that we were able to put it on successfully, and not only did we get the turbans right, but the uniforms were specially made for us, and the rifles came from South Sea in Plymouth, so we had expert help as well. And so this was the production. We were lucky that it got photographed by the Theatre Museum. They only photograph X amount of shows every year, because as you know, there's hundreds of shows on in London. And so now, in order to buy the images back, this is one of our own images, we have to pay the Victoria and Albert Museum to buy them back. But we're very happy to do that, because thank God that they photographed it and the Theatre Museum had it, because they've preserved those from 98, which to me feels like 100 years ago now. So that's the production. And this is the programme which was picked up by the Open University as well to give voice to Indian soldiers in World War I. Now, when we talk about India, we're talking about undivided India. So for us, it's a code for saying this. It's Hindus, Muslims, Sikhs. But, you know, really, we also have felt that it's not enough to say undivided India. So we've started to add Hindu, Muslim, Sikh and others as well. So it becomes implicit that there is, that we're also talking about Pakistan and Bangladesh as well. And if you go to the Open University under Mulk Rajanan, this still, I think, shows up. And we've recently met the person who actually put this up for the Open University. It's Dr. Florian Stadler at Exeter University in the English department. And we're really pleased to be working with him for some stuff in the autumn. Now for the centenary years, we started to, Mulk died in 2004. And so, a lot happened, so I'm just really compressing a lot of stuff here now. But the more I went into this, the more I realised how and who were involved, who were these soldiers, and why their story needs telling. And it's become more and more important, really, to tell people of colour that really they also have a stake in Britain, and that, you know, it's hard to think of it now because our perception of the Western Front and the other theatres of war isn't that there were any people of colour there, but the fact is that the French had colonies, and Britain really needed its colonies, particularly India, because it provided 1.5 million soldiers right at the beginning of the war, especially. So this is sort of, we're not pushing it as heritage literature, which undoubtedly it is, but as a good read, as a cultural thing, as a literature thing. And so we will bring back a production, but towards the end in 2018 or 19, a new production. But before that, we're looking at now the voices of the soldiers and also the voices of the families in particular as well. So only in the last year or two, we've come across in a beautiful exhibition that took place here at the Brunei Gallery, Empire, Faith and War. I don't know, did anybody see that exhibition? Wasn't it fantastic? It's a brilliant exhibition. Mm. Now it's focusing on Sikh soldiers, but Sikhs are a very small, tiny minority, even in undivided Punjab. But their contribution in the Indian Army and British Indian Army was huge, about 20%. So 1% of the population represented 20% of the army in World War I. So that exhibition that you saw, and I saw, I live in Cardiff, I came 3 times to see it. And but one of the items in that exhibition was a little postcard, I think about this size, and it was a letter written by a young girl to her soldier father, and it's the Kishan Devi postcard. Now Kishan Devi came from rural Amritsar region, and we know that girls weren't sent to school at the turn of the last century. You know, they would, there was no system, and they wouldn't have been, particularly from a rural area. And so Kishan Devi more than likely learned to read and write at the Gurdwara or the temple. And the letter is heartfelt. We have an English translation, and it's, every time we've done this event, the Kishan Devi postcard event, I think Hai Ching came to the last one, it was so moving because it cuts across your cultural boundaries and so on, and you get to understand how the families might have felt. That is where we are, in that we're working with people who've got artifacts as well, and bringing them to life to tell this story. And of course, we were lucky enough to launch the World War I centenary edition of Across the Black Waters. And one of the bugs for me was that it never had an Indian soldier on the cover. So one of the first things we did was to have a new cover and to show. And there's going to be an e-book as well. And our aim is to reach really over 1 million of a new generation of audiences. And we're not aiming it at only South Asians or whatever. We want to reach this story to a wider audience, because we think it's important for as a good piece of literature too, for everyone, and a good story and a good yarn too. Good way to learn about the First World War. Thank you.
Thank you, Dominic. Let me add that actually we also got some money through the Meridian Society to do an oral history of the Chinese Labour Corps. So we are hoping that we would work together on the next production. Now, I'm going to introduce Hwee-San Tan and Clarissa is going to look after the next bit, which is all about extras and also paper cake.
Yeah.
Right. No, not yet paper cake.
Right.
It's only one slide long, guys.
What I have to say will be brief. So I'm going to be talking just a little bit about the Crossdress Festival, which Hwee-Ching has already mentioned. Hwee-Ching and I go back over 20 years. We are partners in crime, if you can call it that, you know, in trying to promote Chinese arts all these years. And then, of course, he's gone on to do the Indian, you know, India arts in collaboration with India and then Southeast Asia, which I was also, you know, briefly involved in. And then now this whole of Asia alliance that we're getting, you know, growing bigger and bigger over time. So the Crossdress Festival. So what exactly is the Crossdress Festival? This is a festival that is a festival for you. So the AAAHA is a family of alliances. So you are involved. If you're not already a partner, we urge you to become a partner of this, and we can all work together. And this festival, over the 2 weekends, on the 2nd and 3rd of July and the 16th and 17th of July, will take place in SOAS and as part of SOAS's greater centenary celebrations as well. And what it will be is really a platform for you. So please, you know, if you haven't been in touch, so there are all kinds of performances, there are acts, and, you know, there some of the performances include, and our artists are here, some of the artists are here, and they're already presenting. They will be presenting very shortly about what exactly they're going to do, but I'll just give you some examples. So there will be, for instance, not only a kind of new projects that are coming up. So for instance, you have multidisciplinary theatre projects that are fronted by the Singapore Bhumi Collection, who will also be performing at the Edinburgh Fringe Festival. So they are coming, you know, to do a little short short performances as part of the festival. And then there will be also traditional art forms, such as a kunchi artist performing kunchi in the festival, coming especially from China. And we have also the Vietnamese Triclone Theatre with some Vietnamese stories, etc. So there are sound art projects by Tekla, who you will hear from later. And then as part of a privately sponsored Buddhist calligraphy exhibition, there are lots and lots of performances, such as the Chin Zither performance with calligraphy workshop, tea ceremony in the Japanese garden. So all these are going to be performances and opportunities for us to showcase what you are doing throughout the weekends. So please get involved, and by, you know, advertising or among your communities, your arts partners, etc., and all that, please spread the word. I'll pass it on.
Yeah.
You to Clarissa, who will tell you a little more.
Yeah, she has a piece of paper in her hand because she had to do some slides before. So why have we set up Crossdrifts? Crossdrifts is, again, set up for you guys. And during Crossdrifts, international local artists will interact, merge practices, and integrate their ideas and share outcomes with each other. So it's a platform to talk. At the same time, exploring their notions of cultural identity and reimagined contemporary arts practices. We want to establish a new interface model to provide fresh opportunities for contact, discussion, collaboration, communication, and exchange for ideas for artists, academics, and think tanks. Out of this activity, we will be able to further develop the outcomes, and this will help us, this is all of us, position ourselves as an alliance to best serve the artistic interests of our memberships and partners. It's supposed to be an R&D space. It's a space to play, try things out, and pave a way forward to foster new practices and understandings. The result of the interactions with each other will shape new creative realities that inform innovative activities. We're really interested in dialogues about, obviously, global diaspora identities. It's about who are you. The notion of identity has come up so often. It really, really presses the point on how important it is for all of us, really. The festival will take place from the 2nd and the 3rd of July and the 16th and the 17th of July here at SOAS. There are some other performances that will happen outside of this building, which will happen probably in August. Now, I urge you to take a picture of this so you could follow us, or just take your phone out and do a do a quick Twitter follow. I'm also going to send around this email list so you can sign up and we can keep you updated on anything that's going to happen.
I think that's it. Yes, that's it for us. So please sign up so we can keep you all involved. Now we're going to bring on some of the artists, not all of them. We're going to start with the Bhumi Collective, who are from Singapore, a Muslim organization. I want to hear all about you. Thank you.
Are you going to do? Oh, it's only three. You want to do your own slides?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'll just wait.
Yeah. Hi. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I think, as Hai Ching has mentioned, we're called the Bhumi Collective. And what is the Bhumi Collective? And to tell you that, I'm just going to tell a little bit of a short story about how, when stars align, and things happen. So I'm Shai, I'm Shaiful, you can call me Shai, and I'm functioning as a producer for the Bhumi Collective. I am currently in London pursuing my MA in creative producing at the Royal Central School of Speech and Drama. And being here, I was wondering, you know, spending a year here, wondering what to do with my theatrical journey in London and whatnot. Sometime in December, a childhood friend of mine reaches out and says, can you tell me more about accommodation in London? And I said, why? And he said, because I'm coming over to London. And I'm like, oh, how long are you going to be in London for? I'm going to be there till about August or September, because the last part of my master's in dance anthropology, I will be at the University of Roehampton. And I'm like, are you kidding me? This is a childhood friend. We go way back. We started about the same time, 10, 11 years ago. But we've never had a chance to work together because I've been mostly doing theatre. He's been doing traditional Malay dance. But our path has been quite similar because we ended up doing similar jobs in education as well, in different schools and whatnot. And then I said, are we crazy? And then he was like, what do you mean by that? I said, let's do a show here. I think it's finally time for us to come together and do a show after 10, 11 years of wanting to do it together. Not in Singapore, but here. And that was when, you know, as Dr. Tan mentioned, I mentioned Edinburgh. And he said, okay. And that was when we discovered other people, other fellow Singaporeans, aspiring artists. We're all young aspiring artists. And to be in this room with a lot of you who have been here, who have been doing this for a long time, and here we are, just about to start this journey, is really very humbling. And we found... that gentleman is Amin over there, who's now operating the camera. I forgot to mention him. So he's choreographing and directing the piece. And we found our music director, Nabila, who's over there. And she's currently at the Royal College of Music at the end of her BA studies, doing piano. And then we found Zunor, who's over there. And she's currently a student at the London Contemporary Dance School. Stars aligning. And then we said, let's go to Edinburgh. Why not? Are you guys crazy enough to join me on this journey? And they all said yes. And here we are. And then through this, Dr. Tan heard about us and then introduced us to Hai Ching and got us involved in AAAHA. And so what are we doing in Edinburgh, as been mentioned? So we were wondering. So we decided to call the show Bhumi. Bhumi is, of course, Sanskrit, or in the Malay language, earth or soil. Because back home, we being from the Malay race, we're the indigenous people of Singapore and whatnot. But then we're a minority race, and we're finding our place in Singapore as artists and as whatnot. You know, trying to find our arts journey and career. And then we decided to come to London, where we're even a further minority. And we said, well, that's what our show is going to be about, finding our place in the world, talking about this identity. How do we negotiate our identity and whatnot? And we're going to explore that through traditional Malay dance, and then we thought that's not going to be enough. Let's explore it with a contemporary form as well. And that's where this kind of like stars aligning, as I mentioned, was perfect, because we had Zunor, who's our assistant choreographer and also performing in the show, who's working with different dancers at LCDS. And now our company of performers consists of Singaporeans and British dancers as well, who are going to be doing Malay dance as part of the show. And it's been quite a fascinating journey watching them do different Malay dance moves and whatnot, and coming in and just watching it. And it's really amazing. So, without going too much into detail about it, we're just going to share with you a little bit more about the details of our show. We're in transit, obviously, trying to find a place. So we will be at the space at Nidra Street in Edinburgh from the 15th to the 27th of August. That will be the second and third week. And we're in the fundraising phase at this point in time. This is not an appeal for funds. But we want to welcome people who want to sort of join us in supporting us on this journey. Even if you are going to like our Facebook page, or even you're just going to check in and ask, well, how are you guys doing, or come and visit us and whatnot, I think that's greatly appreciated to be a part of this community of people. And before we go to Edinburgh, as Dr. Tan mentioned earlier, we will be a part of the Crossroads Festival in July on those dates. We will be sharing, we will be presenting. So if you can't make it to Edinburgh, we will be presenting a little bit more, a sample of what we're going to do. And we will be talking about the process of it, of developing the work as well. So if you want to find out more, or and join us on this journey that we are having, we'll be right outside after this whole event is over. Thank you very much.
Okay, now from minority to majority. Here we have Mary Ann, who is also currently a founder director of AAAHA, with her sidekick, Mike Dodsworth.
Can you bash the buttons for me? Thank you. Well, hello. Welcome to our new friends. you might wonder what we're doing here and how I connected with Hai Ching. I think it was about 4 years ago we worked on a major project, and as he's an old dancer and I'm an old dancer, I come from show business way back in the 60s, the late 50s, and I've been in the arts all my life, and we immediately had a rapport that only dancers have, basically. And it's been incredible to make lots of new friends. So here we are. I don't quite know why I'm here, but I'm thrilled to be here, and I'm thrilled to be a director of AAAHA, because I think this is the way forward. This is amazing. So you would like to probably know something about what we do. I'm a creative director of Pinpoint Create. When I retired, it's a long story, and I've been an arts officer, I've been a teacher, I've been a performer on television, I've been done all sorts of things in my life. When I retired, I didn't want to retire because I still thought I had more to do. So I decided to start my own arts company and got hooked up with a very long time friend, Mike here. We used to teach together, and David and Tony, who's our resident writer, and decided that we would do something that everybody said wouldn't work, and actually 1,500 people turned up. So, I knew, as we were saying early, it's really important for you to follow your vision on what you want to do. And if you guys want to do something, just go and do it. And if people say it won't work, don't take any notice of them if you know what you're doing. Anyway, I'll tell you something about Pinpoint. We're based in the UK, actually in Southend-on-Sea and Chelmsford, which is the outer reaches of Essex. I'm an Essex girl, East London Essex girl, always been based here. We like to reinvent tradition, and we've been very fortunate in having a lot of Heritage Lottery funding and ACE funding ever since I decided I wanted to get on with this. We like to put lots of different art forms together. Though I'm obviously more interested in dance, Mike is our artistic director, he's a brilliant theatre director. If I want something composed, I go to David and say, can you write me this, please? And if I want something written, I always go to Tony Michaels and say, can you put this together? I'd like this written, please. So, you know, I'm a bit sort of pushy. We make theatre in site-specific and historic traditional locations. So we like to do all sorts of different things. And we like stories and legends around the concept of the international story, but making it, bringing it to people's hearts and minds, basically. So we go from all sorts of different things. Whatever takes, catches your imagination, you go with it. And we like working with communities and with education. I'm also a director of a large learning community, so education is kind of important. The new younger generation coming through, and it's in a very deprived area, so it's kind of important to me that we do those sort of things. So next, please. Yes, okay. So this is what we like doing. We like making things happen. I like making things happen. We built a theatre in a listed building. That was a major, huge project. 40 performances, thousands of kids, thousands of artists, professional show, etc. And then we've done other things. We ran a festival at the end of Southend Pier, a mile and a half out to sea, telling stories at the end of the pier. So we've got to go from big things to little things. You go where there's no such thing as a small show. Thank you. Okay. I was fortunate. I was arts officer for Thurrock Thames Gateway for 7 years, and it was when the Labour government were in and we had lots of money. It was wonderful. And I was able to sort of fulfil all sorts of dreams about doing things that I wanted to do, but actually engaging with the community. So actually, we actually knocked lots of famous people off their podiums at the V&A when we won the the regional and the national arts and business community award. That was a very good moment, that was. They said, oh, I see, oh, you know, rubbish. And, you know, the Royal Opera House, the Vietnam, and all this sort of thing. And we knocked them off their podium, which was good. So that was a big commercial Christmas show. And it had loads of children, and everybody said, you can't do a nativity. Nobody does nativities anymore. And every school signed up because it's a jolly good story. You don't have to be religious. We go with the stories. And having come from the theatre and the commercial theatre, I wanted to have a commercial show as well. So we did Christmas around the world, celebrations around the world, whatever we fancied. So that was a good thing. And I've actually got the award on my kitchen shelf now because we stole it from Thurrock Council. It's quite funny. Okay, can I have the next one, please? Okay. And then with Tony and Mike, we did two Heritage Lottery productions. We did timepieces, which was telling the story of the foundation, the digging of the port of Tilbury on the River Thames, which was dug out by labourers from all over the world by hand, and they dug this amazing port. And that was really good because we did musical, which I have a bit of a fondness for. That was in a derelict building. And then we recreated the opening by Ramsay MacDonald. And Mike, you were the storyteller, weren't you? Because Mike is an international storyteller. So he was the storyteller. You held the whole piece together. It was sort of a Doctor Who thing, wasn't it? You arrived in a mini. It was quite great fun. And we had loads and loads, about 1,000 school children came and learnt this story. Next, please. Yes. And then that was so successful, fortunately, the Heritage Lottery funded us again. And we told the next story, which was the arrival of the Empire Windrush and the how it influenced British music. In fact, London is the place for me, is actually the first time I've heard that number on Paddington, the new film of Paddington. And they use that fantastic, what's the guy's name?
Lord Kitchener.
Lord Kitchener, who came from the West Indies, and he sang that on the steps of the, so we recreated all that, the Windrush, when they arrived in England.
He composed it on the boat on the way over.
Yeah.
As an introduction to
yeah, and it was recreated in the film Paddington, actually. I'm surprised they didn't use it in the Olympics. It's such a wonderful piece. And yeah, that was another one, and the repatriation of, you know, the different people that came over after the Second World War. And there you are. Lovely little boat. We went round the railway station. That was great fun. And also the people that went to Australia, the £10 bombs that went off to Australia, because that was a big, big migration. Okay, yes. Okay, next. Okay. We're also fortunate to be asked to do the opening ceremony. We did the story of Marconi for Chelmsford City Council, which was quite exciting. It was nice to be part of the Olympics. Next, please, yes. And our biggest production was Beowulf, because we're really keen on medieval stuff and ancient stories. They're international. And we did this in the park. And we did a big educational project. David wrote a new opera for it, which was actually it's still with the National Theatre. I'm still waiting for them to send it back and say no, but they've had it for about 18 months. So anyway, that was a year-long project. And next, please. Yes, sorry, I'll hurry. we did Priory People. That was a local project telling the story of a local family, and they created a newspaper, then they went off to war. And that was a big educational project. And we did a festival that year as well. That was Heritage Lottery. And next, please, yes. Oh, and then I worked with Hai Ching on this amazing production of Noy's Flood, which we performed in Southend, then in Thurrock, and then at the Southwark Cathedral, all in one week, with the Britain Symphonia and 100 kids with all your wonderful masks and things, and a youth orchestra and professional opera singers, and it nearly killed me because it was the hottest week of the year. But it was that was funded by the Arts Council. Next, please, yes. And this is our latest project, which we've just finished, which was a World War One commemoration of our local town, Southend. And that involved lots of community groups. We did our own production, but lots of schools did bits as well. They did their own shows and they explored their own history, particularly the convent and, you know, how they came in through it. And David wrote some new music for that. And next, that's it. I think now our new project, which we're waiting for Arts Council funding, is a medieval wagon, and we're going to use an international cast of five, but we hope to use all sorts of dancers and people that might be over this year from India or wherever, you know, we're going to put them into the show. And we're hoping to tour this medieval wagon, which will tell stories of the world. And then next year we'll go to a different country. We'll start off with England, then we'll tell Indian stories and Chinese stories, and we hope that people that are here would want to be part of it. It would be really nice. But we've got to get the money first, and that's always the hard thing. And Mike is going to take over because he's got a nice story to tell you which reflects what we want to do.
Yes, this is a tribute to the spirit of collaboration. And this is one of my favourite stories, which I think its original source is Eastern Germany, perhaps Russia. For the story begins at a time of famine. And so the people of the village began to first gather, then hoard, and then hide. What? Food. Yes, food became that precious commodity. So much so that they wouldn't share it with their very next door neighbour. Oh no, I haven't got any food. Have you got any food? We could use some food. We could all use some food, they said. None of us have got food. One day a traveller came to the village, a person who doesn't belong anywhere, but belongs everywhere. And this traveller could see what was happening in this village. It became very apparent. And upon asking the question, does anyone have any
food?
He received the answer, no. In fact, you should move on. Go to a different district. There's no food here. There's a famine, don't you know? Well, I won't move on, said the traveller, for I already have everything I need. In fact, and he set up a pot in the market square, set a fire under the pot, drew water from a well into the pot, and with great ceremony pulled out a velvet bag, and from the velvet bag plopped a stone. A stone, he said, for I am about to make stone soup, and I will share it with all of you. Oh, at the thought of food, people flocked. Plop went the stone into the water. And so the traveller made a great show of stirring and savouring and tasting and oohing and aahing and smacking of lips. And people drew even closer, wanting to have a taste. He was reluctant to give them a taste, for he said, this soup is good, but it would be better with some cabbage. Lo and behold, a cabbage appeared from one of the hordes, from the person who had... And so it went on, many contributions. A shin of beef, mushrooms, carrots, onions, garlic would be good. It would be so much better with some garlic, don't you know? Or some local herbs, or whatever people... people began to bring their food and put it into the pot. And soon, the smell, the savoury smell of a decent, thick, rich soup filled the air, and bowls appeared, and bread had been made, and that evening the village shared the first decent meal for a long, long time. The end.
Thank you. I wish we hadn't been to the hare and tortoise. We could have still soup. No, I know. What? Now we're up to you, aren't we?
Yeah, we are.
Yes, Clarissa is going to talk about paper gangs with Simon.
Hi, everyone.
Hello.
Hello, hello, hello. Clarissa and myself, we are Paper Gang Theatre. Basically, we are a platform for British East Asian writers to develop and produce work for the stage. All that means is that we help writers get better. Ideally from a British East Asian background, but to be honest, we work with pretty much anyone that's interested and enthusiastic. What does develop mean? That could mean a cup of coffee, that could mean workshops, that could mean reports, that could mean anything that basically gets you just a little bit better. We know how hard it is to get something from your brain to the page and to make sense and translate well to someone else. We hopefully smooth out all those little kinks to get it to translate well. We also produce work, partly because we also understand that a script is only a blueprint for someone else to go and make it. So we produce, we get things on their, at their feet, page to stage. Clarissa's much better at talking about that than I am. I'm terrible at that. So,
is that the next?
Yeah, the next bit. So, Clarissa, artistic director, I'm the literary manager, very loose job titles, we move around a lot. So if there's anyone out there who's looking for help in any way just to get that little bit better, drop us a line and we'll see what we can do.
So I'm going to talk quickly about a few projects that we did. January 2015, we did Harajuku Girls, written by Frances Turney. We co-produced it at the Finborough Theatre, 3 weeks long. It was lovely. It was about a coming-of-age story in Japan. Again, it is by a British East Asian writer, not set in Britain as such. So, you know.
It was, on that one, I mean, we did helped out a lot of the post-production work. We did a lot of the marketing, a lot of sleepless nights, a lot of helping people out and doing all that.
Paper Gang Matinees, which was the end of last year, which was our first Arts Council funded project. We are not funded, so we're working from project to project. It was a 3 week long project, and we had three scripts that we developed. Each script got a week of workshopping with the actors, with the cast, for the writer to listen to their script and see, hear their words and how it all worked and how the structure all sat together. They did a lot of rewrites. If you want to have an example, you should ask Joyce Lee, who's sitting right over there, who had
right in the middle.
Right in the middle. Ask her about her experience. Ask her how, how everything came about. It was wonderful to have an amazing cast of, as you can see, David Yip and Sarah Lam, for example, participating. And we were, this was part of the Sea Arts Fest from last year, and we were lucky enough to have the matinees donated to us by Young May Bantry the Blues, who was playing at the theatre, Tristan Bates, at the time. At the Bush Theatre, we did a showcase. We had snippets of new writing from loads of different people. Again, R&D space, trying new things out. It was lovely to have a really good audience. It is important for people, even at the early stages, to kind of have a touchstone. We did evaluation forms so people could get feedback on their work at a very early stage so they can work with it. Ah, yeah, coming soon is I'm Just Here to Buy Soy Sauce, which is a new co-production from us. The play is written by Jing and Young, who is from Hong Kong, and the play deals with the effect that Chinese investors have on the London housing crisis. If it sounds familiar, then please come along. It is something that we like to explore. It's the notion of home versus property. For the first few performances, we will be performing a straight script, which will be done at the New Wimbledon Studios the 18th and 19th of May. I give you time to write that down. On the 6th of June at the Old Red Lion, and on the 9th of June at the China Exchange in Chinatown, where we also have a post-show panel discussion with a lady who wrote a book about how to invest in the UK and the CEO from a social housing association. Then, hopefully for the second half, depending on funding, we will change this script into an immersive theatre experience. We are supported by the Arcola for development as well as the New Diorama, and we're really grateful for their support. Hopefully, by September, we'll have a new, from the script that we're working on now, a new, different immersive theatre experience. I think that's it. Are we good?
I believe so.
Yeah, look at
next.
That.
Next!
Right, oh, yes. Do you want to do the... Are we doing the video?
Yes.
I've already set that up.
We've got a video from Tricon Theatre, who can't be here because Anna is in China at the moment. But she very kindly recorded a video for us.
Hi. Hi, I'm Anna Nguyen and I'm the Artistic Director of Tricon Theatre.
I'm Ming Yu Lin and I'm the Creative Producer.
So Tricon in Vietnamese is pronounced Chikon. You can give that a go if you want to, or you can call us Tricon Theatre. In Vietnamese, it means God-given wisdom. So we believe in the Vietnamese culture that everybody is given a specific tricorn to do a specific thing. So for example, as theatre makers, we have been given the tricorn to create and devise theatre. Tricon Theatre started out, quite interesting journey actually, it started out in disused buildings. We did a lot of our work with no central heating. It was very, very cold, and it was not very great and not very glamorous at all, but we persevered, and in a way it kind of gave the work a bit more flavor. But because we made a lot of the work in disused buildings, it kind of took on its form of immersive theater. And that's when we were testing out a lot of the work, we would do it in the disused buildings, and naturally it kind of gravitated towards bringing our audience on a more of a journey than kind of an end-on style type of theatre. We love to take people right into the heart of the story. We really love to bring our audiences as close as possible to the story and the message that we're trying to give out. So when you do come and see a Tricon show or a Tricon event, expect something more than just sitting down. The show was an immersive experience, so audience members came in, were made to give up their identity and become an identity of somebody that was alive during the Vietnam War. There was food to be tasted, there was refugee camps which we put our audiences in. They were made to go and apply for a new job for the first time and attend a graduation scene. So that's really representative of the type of work that we do.
Tricon Theatre is also really about collaboration, whether it's with the community or artists, venue partners, designers and performers.
The collaboration process is really, really key to us, and is really, really important. We're definitely about bringing artists together that we feel have a good chemistry, that would work well together, that can produce something magnificent. And we love to try and produce a ladder of development for them. So Southeast Asian artists, whether they're actors, directors, designers or videographers, we really want to make sure that we can nurture them and give them an opportunity in a world where it's really hard for the underrepresented to get a chance. So a lot of my training as a director came from Christine Landon-Smith from Tomasha Theatre Company. And that's really inspired our practice in the rehearsal room. As directors, we really take that nurturing process really seriously, and we want to always try and find the best way to empower, to unlock and to bring the best out of all of our artists. As the UK's only Vietnamese British theatre company, we feel a great responsibility to create dialogue and encourage integration with the Vietnamese community. And so a lot of the work we do does involve the Vietnamese community.
Yes, Trikon is really about making sure we give people that work with us a good experience, a good environment. And we always want to make sure that after working at Trikon, you've gone away with something that you can really add to your practice.
So Trikon Theatre has worked with CrossDrift Festival, formerly known as Sea Arts Festival, when it first started in 2013. Hwee-Ching is a mentor to the company itself. We've been programmed twice into the festival. The first programming we did was A Dream from a Bombshell, and then we did a smaller project called A Magic Pencil, which was focused around Vietnamese folk tales. And actually this year we are looking to expand that project that we did with CrossDrift Festival into a larger project, and to take that back to the community, to take that back to the festival itself.
Trikon Theatre is a growing company, and we're very open to new dialogue. We're interested in cross-disciplinary collaboration. So even if you're a photographer or installation artist or even an academic, we would welcome hearing from you, and we look forward to seeing how we can collaborate in future.
Yeah, so come and grab us, have a chat with us. We would love to talk to you. You can find out more about us on www.trikontheatre.org.
Okay, unfortunately, Mingyu has got food poisoning, and it wasn't from the hand tortoise. So let me introduce Yame Oina, who is an author, and she's got loads of titles. What's a theatre maker, tiger spirit, what's all that about?
What's all that about? Hi everybody, I'm Yame. I'm from Malaysia of Chinese heritage, but I'm now based in London. As a writer, I'm interested in the stories of strong, powerful, dynamic, independent women, tiger spirit women, and in particular, East Asian women. I started life as a novelist, and back in the day, I was a lawyer, and the discussions about identity really touched me, because this was my experience. I loved reading Amy Tan, but all her stories were about women who'd been through heartbreaks, suffering, terrible things, but in a domestic sphere. I also loved John Grisham, legal thriller, but it was all about white men driving their cars, being chased, mafias, men with guns, and an urban Western landscape. I was a lawyer. Where were the books and the stories about a woman like me? East Asian, lawyer, dynamic, all that sort of stuff. So I decided to write my own. So I wrote these two books, The Flame Tree and Mind Game. They were snapped up by Hodder and Stoughton. They're now reissued by Monsoon Books. In the two novels, the heroine is an East Asian, Malaysian, Chinese woman, and there are men with guns, there are gangsters, there are car chasers, there's a James Bond ending in Mind Game, and it's set in the modern urban landscape of Kuala Lumpur, which is where I'm from, because, you know, we don't all live in little villages, do we? And what was interesting was when it was published by Hodder, the publisher tried to get it into all the different bookshops, and a major railway station bookshop would not take it because they said, it's not Amy Tan, it's not John Grisham, where do we put it? So they couldn't put it in a box. So I think, you know, all this talk about identity and seeing ourselves represented, we've come a long way since then, but I think we still have a long way to go. So My most recent project is Bound Feet Blues, A Life Told in Shoes. Now, I'm not a trained actor. I have no theatre background. So I was just playing around with doing a bit of storytelling. And thanks to Hai Ching and his team back in 2014, they were scouting for shows for the new Southeast Asian Arts Festival 2014. And in the audience of my scratch night was Annie Kwan, Hai Ching's colleague at the time. And she came up to me, and at that time I was working on a half-finished script. I had no director, I didn't really know what I was doing, but I just told the story. And Annie came up to me and said, "We want you in the Southeast Asian Arts Festival." And when someone asks you this question, even though I had no theatre background, I just said, "Oh yes, of course, of course." And inside I was going, "Oh my God, how do I do this?" Through a series of events, I found a director, and we were able to put on a one-night showcase at the Southeast Asian Arts Festival 2014. And as a result of that, we were able to get more funding, and we put on a three-week run at the Tristan Bates last year, November, December 2015. And Bound Feet Blues is the story of my great-grandmother in China who had bound feet. And interwoven in that is my own coming out story. And for me, my great-grandmother was a tiger spirit woman because she had bound feet, but she was married into this family where they treated her really, really badly. They bullied her, made her work in the fields, and she ran away. Imagine for a woman of that time to defy tradition, break her marriage vows, and run away. She managed to make her way to the coast where she boarded a junk to Malaya. And at that time, she had no idea what was going to meet her at the other end. And imagine this little woman with these tiny little feet that was very fragile and unbalanced. And she took this chance. And she went to Malaya. She met the man who became my great-grandfather. And the rest is history. And I wanted to explore this idea of bound feet as a metaphor for the cultural traditions that kept women literally in their place. They couldn't walk. And how we can use that as a metaphor to explore the cultural landscape in modern times around high heels and traditions that keep women nowadays bound in their place. And I guess you could extend that metaphor to think about the cultural landscape around identity, East Asian stereotypes, and so on. So for me, this was a really exciting journey to have been able to become a theatre performer, thanks to Hai Ching and his team. So here is Team Bound Feet Blues, just to give you a sense of who was behind that, putting me a solo performer on stage. And I'm very excited to have been working with a whole bunch of tiger women, with a mix of East Asians and non-East Asians. And so this led me on to my current project, which is called Butterfly in Blue Jeans. It's an East Asian feminist response to Puccini's Madame Butterfly. And it just used to infuriate me. I love the music. You know, Puccini, fantastic music. I want to hate it, but I can't hate it. But the reason I hate it is because this image of the East Asian woman who is docile and submissive and passive and pathetic and kills herself for the love of a white man, goodness me. You know, it's infuriating. I mean, I've been out with white guys before, they're lovely, but, you know, it's created this image of this pathetic East Asian woman, which has a repercussion for us in our modern lives because people see us, women, East Asian women, in a particular way because of these kinds of stereotypes. And I want to tackle in this new play that we're working on the idea of yellow face, this lovely Western woman with her slitty eyes, and also this concept of Orientalism, where the East is evoked as exotic, submissive, sexy, sensual, and how that plays into our modern ideas about East and West. So it's a play, and you can find out more at the website there. And this is Team Butterfly. I'm going to be writing it, the lead actor will be Julie Cheong In-hin, because I decided as a non-professional actor, it was really too exhausting to be on the stage, so I'd rather somebody else do it. And we have Paper Gang helping us, producer, and fantastically exciting Tiger Spirit women, except Simon, who is an honorary woman. So if we can get funding, it would be really exciting. If we can get funding, we would go to hopefully produce a staged reading at Crossdrifts 2017 as the end of phase one. That hopefully will then lead to phase two, which will be a full production of the play. So this is me. If you want to keep in contact, please take a photo. And it would be great to chat with everybody afterwards and also keep in touch. Thank you very much.
Thank you, young man. Now we're going to leapfrog because Jeanette is unfortunately has a bit of a problem. So we're going to go to David. David, I worked with a few years ago. He does writes some wonderful music, and he works with differently able people.
Yes, differently able.
Yes.
Would you like me to? Yes, he's on a loop, I think, so it might just have happened, hopefully. Well, good evening, everyone. First of all, can I say how wonderful it is to be here representing an organisation that works for people with learning disabilities. And we're very proud that we're here as the first organisation, and the fact that we are represented, and moving forward, we want to develop that and work with you all. It's absolutely fantastic. We haven't got much time, which is why I've got slides going on and I'm going to talk, but there won't be many words after that bit. So the Music Man Project is the UK's first full-time music education service that's specifically for people with learning disabilities. It's something that I started 15 years ago, just as a Saturday music school. My own background is I'm a classically trained musician and a composer with Pinpoint, Create, and all sorts of other things I've done. And then I went into education and left as a deputy head teacher in 2012. And I decided to put that aside and change sort of the route of my career and run a full-time music education service for people with disabilities. And the real thrust behind our work is that we have to have our education, it has to be enjoyable, and it has to lead to performances. So what I'm here to tell you today is that many people, I'm sure not here, but many people might assume that those people you see on the screen wouldn't be able to access the arts in the same way as that we do, and certainly wouldn't be able to put on big performances and then be entertaining and engaging and the like. Well, I'm here to say that we have moved on, and they certainly are. And with a particular patience and a particular approach, we can actually achieve something that's quite remarkable with people with learning disabilities. What I try and do, and my way in is, if you like, is that I believe that everybody has innate musicality. It's the very reason that if I go dum, da-da-da-da-da, boom, boom, most people will do that. And they will even sneeze in time as well. That's fantastic. That's my way in, as it were. And what we've found is that you might explain things a certain way and it won't be accessible at all, because of our students, they are from all sorts of different backgrounds with different disabilities. We do not turn anybody away. So it's in complete range of learning disabilities. But those same people performed at the London Palladium in June 2015. And it was a remarkable night. And we performed there with about 150, maybe 200 by the time we had all the children as well on the stage. And since that night, it's our work has really grown to such an extent that we are now setting up other centres around the UK. In August, we're going to South Africa to teach children in a chain of care homes for orphans with learning disabilities. And we've set up lots of other places. And I do training to encourage other teachers to do the same. So the end goal within the next couple of years is to have 12 Music Man projects around this country and to be linking internationally so that we can share our work and inspire others to do the same. It's really become a bit of a campaign. We're talking about vision and having a dream. Well, my vision for this is for it to be a campaign for equal rights for people with learning disabilities to be able to perform. And not just to perform anywhere, but to perform at the most prestigious venues, because that way we can educate the wider society about what they can do, not what they need, not what their disabilities are, but actually how the arts, and particularly for my case music, just transcends all that, and they inspire you just as much as their families and the work that they're doing. So that's taken us on quite a journey, which has happened very, very quickly. The charity single that was up there is called Music is Magic, and that's become our sort of guiding the phrase. And that charity single for one day was at the top of Amazon's Broadway song chart, and it pushed down Andrew Lloyd Webber's Phantom of the Opera for one day, just by the amount of sales we had at the play. And we talked a lot, haven't we, about identity. And if you think about the identity for people with learning disabilities, for a lot of them, they do not have an identity. They don't have something that they say, I am this, or I can do this, or this is my cultural heritage. They do not understand those concepts. But what they do understand is that they can now say, I performed in the West End. I sang this solo. A selective mute only a couple of years ago now sang on that charity single, The Last Line. Such is the power. I don't need to tell you about the power of music for helping and all that music therapy side of it. What I'm saying is we've moved on from that in many ways now. Now we are just teaching music, teaching creativity and entertainment, all that sort of stuff for people with disabilities, and they are doing it. So it led to the London Palladium. Our next concert we are trying to book at the moment is the Royal Albert Hall, because we've got so many more people that are coming on board with us that we now need a bigger stage than the Palladium. I'm all right, Marianne, the Palladium is one of the biggest stages in the West End, but it was a ridiculous squeeze, the sort of stress on the afternoon of getting all these, everybody in the wheelchairs and all the orchestra we had and choir, meant that we now need a bigger venue. And I say to you all here, especially the artists and the other organisations, if you want to be involved in that, guest appearances, we had Circus Raj with Hwee Ching organised for us to come and do a guest item with us at the Palladium. We would love you to be involved. It's a great opportunity for everyone. But the stars of the show are the ones with learning disabilities. I write the music and we get as much people in as possible, the highest production values we can. A few other very quick things. Natalie is here. Natalie Bradford is a co-tutor at the Music Man Project. She runs her own centre in Malden. She is a Royal College of Music PhD student, and her PhD is on the impact of music on the lives of people with learning disability. So everything that we are doing at the Music Man Project is contributing to PhD research. So in a few years' time, we'll not only have real evidence, what I call, you know, doing the show, actually having the impact on people, we'll actually have academic research, scientific research, which actually says what they're doing and in terms of health and well-being, how music is making that impact. We also have lots of great support from Royal Mencap and other big organisations behind us. And the last thing, I hope I'm fitting in my 5 minutes here, this is good. The last thing, at the London Palladium, and this is all about really what we managed to achieve in terms of the journey we've come on, and we've spoken a lot about that this evening. I wrote a musical for the second half of the Palladium show. And this musical told the story of really the journey that people with learning disabilities have come to. Because if you can imagine, even 50 years ago, the thought of having a West End show, a Sunday night at the London Palladium, as we called it, completely performed by people with learning disabilities would have been absolutely impossible. Because a lot of these people, and it might well be similar in other parts of the world now, a lot of these people were just isolated in mental hospitals, along with anybody else that society couldn't quite understand. And so at the London Palladium, we did a musical, and it was called From the Asylum to the Palladium. And it was performed by the students themselves. And it was the most moving thing you could possibly imagine. And if you do get a chance, if you go to www.themusicmanproject.com and do see me afterwards for more details, you can actually see a complete footage of our show at the Palladium with that musical. So I want to say thank you, and thank you, Hwee Ching, for inviting me here. And it's going to be a very exciting time in the future, because I want to reach out, share what we do here in the UK with you. Thank you.
Thank you, David. That's great. Now we're going to come to Thekla Ek, and as Thekla is going to talk about her work, we're going to mic up Miss Anna Chen in a little while so that we can record you properly. Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Hi, everyone. So recently I started to give myself the name Ek Am Alien. Ek is my family name, and actually it sounds very much like ik, in it means me, in I mean I in Dutch. So I'm basically saying I am an alien. I started with this concept of creating art from the point of view of an alien. I mean, like, I do not understand the way the world is, and like the aliens are kind of telling humans how to live a better life. Yeah, so basically I'll start from the start. I was born and raised in Belgium. My parents are Cambodian. They're refugees from the Khmer Rouge. Maybe some people have heard of it. And I was raised in a very traditional Khmer household. And it started until my puberty, when I started to feel conflicts. How do you say, at home and with myself, like I couldn't fit myself anywhere. Like, I loved the Khmer culture, the dance, the music, but there was a part that I couldn't see myself at all. And then when I said that I'm Belgian, my parents were like, no, look at your skin, you're not. And so I had this conflict of identity within me, and this is how I started then making sound works, where you can hear me singing, telling stories, as well stories from my mom of what she has been through, and she hasn't told me everything. But I'm in my stories, I explain it in metaphors. In my performances, I also start from traditional Cambodian dance. And my paintings, drawings are very much influenced by political happenings that I see around the world. I've been very interested in it because my parents, they're still political active. They still go striking around the world for human rights in Cambodia, and it really had a big impact on me. It always made me interested in human trafficking, refugees, war. And that's why I get a lot of inspiration from stories and happenings that I see in the newspaper. For Crossdrift Festival, I created a sound work, which you will hear a draft, it's not finished yet, where I record people of different languages. I call it a painting of layers of sounds. Actually, Hai Ching inspired me to do this. It's intended to support, I mean, to be a part of a collaboration with artist Nadan Pon, who is a Cambodian dancer. He's in a wheelchair, but he's a professional dancer. From Stop Gap Dance, I don't know if everyone knows it. And then Diani So, he's a sculptor, Khmer sculptor, who has been here for 10 years. And it's a collaboration with them. But I've also asked the people that I've asked to be involved with the sound work to probably sing on stage during the Crossdrift Festival. So you'll hear lots of languages. But basically, people are asking the same questions, like, who are you? Where do you come from? You do not look like you are from here. Where are your parents coming from? These sentences have always been in my mind because as a Belgian, I mean, Cambodian, Belgian, I've always been approached by Belgians, like, where do you come from? And I'm like, yeah, I was born here. They're like, no, I mean, where are your parents from? So I started to use all these typical sentences. I wrote them down, and I've given them to other people from other nationalities to read them. And at the same time, you hear a layer where I sing a bit, where I'm asking the questions as well. And people are reading as well the definition of identity. the work is a bit, yeah, it's about diaspora, immigration, and I'm trying to involve people from all nationalities. At the moment, I've recorded in Spanish, Italian, Kurdish, French, Dutch, Khmer, Russian, German, and my aim is to record as much languages as possible. So there are still a lot of languages that I haven't recorded yet. So if there is anyone who wants to be involved, please approach me. I've got cards with me. And also, I would like to ask people to sing as well. And anyone that wants to be involved, please come. It will be very interesting because I also made choir work and I really like to work with people from everywhere. I think it will be very nice. So, yeah. This is what I do.
Thank you. Thank you for playing a song and working a while. I want to take this opportunity to introduce you to my good friend Emma Chen, whose birthday it is today. So happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you.
37 again.
Yes, again and again and again. And she's very, very witty, aren't you?
Put me on the spot, thank you.
Yes, you are. Well, okay.
Thank you. Well, thank you very much for inviting me. I was born in Hackney, in the Far East of London, to a couple of communists, actually. So it always felt to me as if at that time that I sort of had Beatlemania screaming in one ear and the Red Guards yelling in the other. So it was a very strange sort of push and pull. I had my first poetry published by Jonathan Cape when I was 14. Such a great start, and then a long, 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 long gap, unfortunately. And in 1994, I realised that I was told I was never going to play Juliet. I was never going to play Ophelia. How could I possibly? Hadn't I looked in the mirror? So I wrote a one-woman show called Susie Wrong, Human Canon. Which I took to the Edinburgh Fringe Festival. Yes, it was. So I took that to the Edinburgh Fringe Festival, and I think I'm the first Chinese Brit to have done that. I don't know, but I'd be very interested if someone can find someone else who predates that. I'll kill you. No, please do tell me. And all right, I'll start with this. It's called Kicking a Dinosaur. And it really happened. I kicked a dinosaur in the tail one day. I didn't have to run away for 5 whole minutes. It's a bit like when you stub your toe and you have time to smoke a fag, read a paper, and murmur, "This is really going to ow." Or like the time I undid the zipper of the new cushion, expecting a sensible inner stocking of filler, as the existence of a zip implied. A removable case, cleaning for the purposes of. It lied. Teeth disengaged, guts disgorged. I sat for the best part of a Jurassic era before the shock struck, an electrical pulse crawling like wet cement along the spinal column of Lizard Girl, stretching time till synapses fired their shots into basal nuclei and words and pictures materialized, juddering and sharpening and melding into one hallelujah revelation that some idiot had funneled thousands of tiny grey balls the size of dinosaurs' brains straight into the gaily patterned cushion cover, and they were now spilling all over me. It was lucky I was wearing knickers, or I would have been pumping out polystyrene pellets like ping pong balls in pat pong, and there would be another cruel stereotype reinforced, a bit like the picture taking shape in your mind's eye around about now. Thank you. I make occasional radio programs for Radio 3, Radio 4. I had my own series on Resonance FM called Madame Meow's Culture Lounge. One of the programs I made was about Anna May Wong. I trust we all know who Anna May Wong is in this room. She was Hollywood's first superstar. She was the most famous Chinese woman in the 1920s and 30s. She was third generation all-American girl, actually. She spoke she was Californian, born in California. Her grandparents had come over. One was a miner, her father ran a laundry. So she became this amazing star. And the most famous film you might have heard of is a film called Shanghai Express with Marlene Dietrich. And she was so amazing. She absolutely blew little Marlena off the screen. So you really should see it. But one of the things that happened, because she was so beautiful and sexy, of course, she had to die. She had to be punished for attracting the white male. And because of various miscegenation laws, she wasn't allowed to kiss her leading man unless he was Chinese, even if he had the tape at the eyes. So anyway, I wasn't very pleased when I knew about this. So I wrote this, Anna May Wong Must Die, because she did. She had to die in every one of her films. Down in the alleys of old Chinatown, in the gaudy bawdy back streets of sinister renown, dope peddlers peddle, the dragon gets chased. It's the same old story, the same yellow face. The man with the Fu Manchu opium embrace could kill you in an instant and never leave a trace. He knows all the tricks how to get you high, and that's why Anna May Wong must die. Down in the sewers of Chinatown Way, Chinamen get chinkified every single day. Little yellow people all merging into one. You eat their rice for punishment, their noodles are no fun. Robotic ant-like army with phasers set to stun, marching across the countryside, nowhere left to run. Here's a tall poppy soaring in the sky, and that's why Anna May Wong must die. Silver screen dreams in black and white, but without the black bits, so that's all right. Along came a flapper, a cute little score. The women went ooh, and the boys went four. Black hair, almond eyes, a figure to adore. Yellow skin glistening, sticking in their craw. There's a comet in the heavens, the end is nigh. And that's why Anna May Wong must die. Who's that upstart flouting all the rules? But one thing or the other, fall between two stools. Is Anna getting cocky? Anna out of line. Anna take your punishment, Anna do your time. Scary Chinese nemesis, looking mighty sly. Crush the dragon lady, the mastermind of crime. Anna kissed a white boy and made him cry. And that's why Anna May Wong must die. Thank you.
Yes, we come to the end, and Anna Chan's got lots of lovely little books with her poems. Yeah. So, anybody's interested. We're now going to play Thekla's sound work. It's, of course, as she says, not complete yet, but it'll give you a flavour, and you can sort of ease your way out and drink some wine, if you need any, because it's all out there. And you can come back,
Who
I'm sure.
Who are you?
Yeah.
Where do you come from? You do not
Where
look like you are from here.
Where
do you do not look like a Belgian. I mean, like, what are your origins? What are your roots? Where do your parents come from?
ແມ່ນມັນດູດວ່າໄດ້ເວີຍໃຫ້ນາຍມັນດູດບາຍພ້ອມແມ່ເອົາມາປີນາອັດຕະສັນຍານເປອັດຕະສັນຍານຄືບາງບັງກາດຈັ່ງປີປຽອັດຕະໃຫ້ນັງສັນຍານອັດຕະມີໃນຄາຄວນຈັກອັດມັນ
Atma, Sanyan, Minaita, Sekaday Dung Jet, Ka Yul Chiba, Sekaday Cho Chap Chang Srong, Krung Samkwal Away Away, Da Pra Chip Krung Samkwal, Katka Nik Mui Nik Mui, Nihau.
Kuka sinä olet? Mistä sinä olet kotoisin? Sinä en näytä siltä, että sinä olisit täältä kotoisin. Et näytä suomalaiselta. Tai siis, mistä sinä olet alkuperäisin kotoisin? Mistä sinun vanhempasi ovat kotoisin?